Hello, and welcome to this new video series about very long baseline interferometry scheduling with VChat++. Before we start, I want to take some minutes to briefly go through some of the concepts and ideas that we are using in scheduling in order for you to better follow the settings that we are using in the tutorials. But first, let's briefly talk about why we need a schedule in the first place. So as you all know, we are doing very long baseline interferometry, and this interferometry part is crucial of why we need a schedule, because we need to make sure that multiple telescopes observe the same source simultaneously. This means we have to coordinate their observations by providing them an observation plan, and this observation plan is what we call a schedule. The generation of this observation plan can be seen as an advanced optimization problem. You have a given station network, you have a given time and a source list, and your task now is to find the best sequence of observations that you can do in order to get the best observation plan for your purpose. So what exactly is a VLBI schedule? So basically, it's simply a text file containing all the necessary information to run the experiment. And this text file is then distributed to all the telescopes and also to the correlator. It lists all the scans that will be observed, as well as which antennas are participating in which scans. Furthermore, it lists a lot of information about how to observe the scans. For example, it lists which frequencies should be observed, which channels should be used, and so on. So what do we need in order to generate a schedule? First of all, we need the basic information about the session. For example, which stations are participating, so what is your station network, what's the start time of the session, what's the duration of the session, and so on. This information can be found in the IVS Schedule Master, where all the IVS sessions are organized. Next, we need some information about the telescopes themselves and also about the sources that we want to observe and the observing mode. Below, you can see the most basic equation that we are using in VLBI scheduling. And based on this equation, you get some hints about which models and information we need. So this equation tells you how long you need to observe a given source in order to reach some desired signal-to-noise ratio. As you can see, you need at least information about the system equivalent flux density of the stations, as well as about the brightness of the source and about the recording rate. And this equation is evaluated for every given baseline and for every observed band. Based on this information, it is then decided how long a station should observe a source. Finally, you need a scheduling software, and in this tutorial series, we are using VChat++. Now, let's briefly talk about some of the concepts we are using in VLBI scheduling. First of all, I want to discuss the sky coverage. So the basic idea here is that you want to distribute your observations in azimuth and elevation over a short time period, and this is important to properly estimate the tropospheric time delays. On the right hand side, you can see an example of a sky coverage. You can read this figure as the following. Your station is here at the zenith, and your sky coverage can be seen as a dome above your station, meaning that this would be your zenith direction, and this would be your horizon. Here, this would correspond to the north direction, east, south, and west, meaning that this is your azimuth axis, while this is your elevation axis. And as I said, what you want to have is you want to have a well-distributed observations over the sky coverage. In this example, the blue dots mark the observations that you take, And here you can see that all the observations are pretty much at the northern direction. And that's an example of a very poor sky coverage. Obviously, if you would like to have a good distribution of azimuth and elevation angles in your observations, this needs to be accounted in the scheduling. The main difficulty here is that having a good or well sky coverage means that your telescopes are slewing a lot, because they are slewing to these different azimuth and elevation angles over a short period of time. The problem here is that while the telescopes are slewing, they cannot observe. On the other hand, one other key requirement in scheduling is that you want to have a high number of observations. In order to get a high number of observations, it is beneficial to have very short slew times. And this is one of the tricky things in scheduling, that you have these different and oftentimes competing requirements, and you now have to find a good compromise or balance between those. Next, I would like to talk about filling modes. So here, it's easiest to explain it based on an example. In this figure, what you see here is that you have six stations in this session, and this is their time axis. What you see here is the observation duration of every station, as well in red, as well as the slew time in blue and the idle time in orange. So let me explain this a little bit. So as you have seen in the previous slides, the equation of the observing duration is calculated per baseline, meaning that it is possible, or usually the case, that all the stations have different observing times. Some stations, like station 4 and 6, are probably less sensitive than other stations, and thus they have to observe longer. Additionally, you probably know that the slew times can also be very different, because first of all, there's different azimuth and elevations for every station, but most importantly, the telescope itself are different and they have different slew times. However, usually a requirement is that these scans, they all have to start at the same time. And this obviously includes some idle time for the stations, because some stations, they might just be more sensitive or faster slewing, so they have to wait for the slow and less sensitive antennas to finish the previous scan in order to be able to start the next one. Obviously, we don't like this idle time in the schedule, because as you know, it's an optimization problem and we would like to have as many observations as possible. So this is where fill-in modes come into play. So here, we are making use of this additional idle, or this idle time that we have at some of the stations, to squeeze in some additional scans with a reduced station network. For example, between scan 1 and 2, it is possible to squeeze in another scan with the first three stations, and between scan 2 and 3, it was also possible to squeeze in another scan with four stations now. Next, I would like to discuss another concept that we are using to reduce the idle time that we have at the stations. So here we have the same situation as before, but I've changed the slew times a little bit. You still see that we have some idle times of this between the scans, but not enough to add real fill-in mode scans. But what we can do is we can simply start to extend the observing time of the previous scans in order to reduce this idle time that we had here. So this basically will make sure that you get a higher signal-to-noise ratio and thus a more precise observation. The downside is that you of course also record more data that has to be shipped to the correlator or sent to the correlator. The next concept is tag-along mode. Here, the basic idea or the basic problem that you want to solve is that you often have a station and you are not sure if the station can really participate in the session, or you are simply not sure if the observations that are recorded by the stations will be useful. Maybe it's a new station and it's still in test mode or something else. So what you can do here is you can put this station in so-called tag-along mode. And what this means is illustrated here. So here we have five stations that are regular stations and one tag-along station. What we are doing is we are first generating the whole schedule only by taking these five regular stations into account. And after the schedule is completed, the next step is to add the tag-along station to as many scans as possible. Obviously, it will not work for all the scans, but you will get some of the scans. And the important thing here is that if the station is not successfully operating or observing, then this does not impact your schedule of the remaining five stations in any way, because the schedule was generated without considering this tag-along station in the first place. So that's a very useful concept if you want to add a new station or test some things with the station. And finally, the last concept I would like to discuss is subnetting. So the main idea here is that if you have a global station network, it is simply impossible that all the telescopes observe the same source simultaneously, because every telescope sees a different part of the sky. Therefore, it is often necessary to kind of split the network into two parts. And here, for example, some stations are observing one source, forming one subnetwork, while some other stations who cannot observe this one source, they are simply using or defining a new subnetwork and observing a different source in the meantime. Subnetting is one of these concepts that is oftentimes misunderstood by the community. For the scheduling algorithm, it is very challenging because it needs to make sure that this splitting of the stations into two parts is done differently between the scans to make sure that not the whole network over the whole session is split into two parts. However, it is simply necessary because, as I said, it is impossible that all the stations in a global network observe the same source simultaneously. The way a schedule is generated is that the algorithm typically generates it scan after scan. By using subnetting, it really helps the algorithm to know what all the stations are doing at the same time. Without subnetting, it will simply generate a schedule scan after scan, but since only a subset of the stations are always able to observe one given source, it will oftentimes simply don't know what all the other stations are doing. And this will lead to a poorer scheduling in general. Additionally, it is to note that allowing subnetting will always be an addition to your scheduling. This means that it will not always be done. The scheduling itself, the algorithm, can decide to often not do subnetting at all, as we will see in the upcoming tasks. This was enough of the theory, and now let's start with scheduling some sessions with VChat++. But before you can start with scheduling, you obviously first have to install the software. You can find the source code on the Weave's GitHub page. The software VChat++ is organized in two repositories. There is one repository for the scheduling software and a second repository for the graphical user interface. If you have a look at the repository, then here on the README page, you'll find some instructions on how to install the software as well as all the dependencies. For example, here is a script that lets you install the software on a plain Ubuntu installation. Additionally, if you go to the release tab, you can see the major releases of VChat++, and for every one of these releases, you will find an installer for Windows as well as some pre-built binaries for Ubuntu. It's oftentimes most convenient to use these installers to install the software yourself. After installing the software, you can start with scheduling. Now, it's finally time to have a look at VShot++ itself. After starting the software, you can see here this small little welcome page. Here I provided some text about how to use the software, as well as some small tutorials. So it's probably a good idea to first read through them. It's important to note that VShot++ includes a built-in help. You can enter the help by pressing the F1 key on your keyboard or by pressing this button here. Note that the icon changed, and if you now hover any element in VShot++ and click on it, you can get some additional help text. On the top here, you see a lot of different icons, and this can be used to navigate through the software. Same here on the side. But you can also use the buttons, the menu at the top. For example, right now we are at the welcome page. Here we would have a look at the general settings of VShot++. The most important sections of VShot++ start here, and these are the most important settings that you can use for generating your schedule. Next, you have a couple of options to either restart the scheduling, load existing schedules, save your settings, run the scheduling software, or exit it. The important part of VShot++ starts with these pages here, because here you define all your settings for the scheduling itself. Let's first have a look at the input page. Here, by default, VShot++ downloads and uses the latest version of the SCAD catalogs. The SCAD catalogs are stored in these folders here, but obviously you can simply browse to your own catalogs in case you want to use them and use them. Next page here is a page about the observing mode. By default, or most of the time, you will use one of the observing modes that is shipped with the SCAD catalogs. You can simply select them here. There are other options as well, but we will not cover them in this tutorial, but probably in a later one. Additionally, here you have the option to define your minimum signal-to-noise ratio for every band. The next page is the general session setup. So here, it is possible to define the start date of your schedule, as well as the duration, and you have some general settings. For example, if you want to use fill-in modes, or if you want to use subnetting, or if you want to extend the observing time in case there is idle time. As I noted before, if you have troubles understanding what it means, simply enter the help mode by pressing your F1 key and clicking on an element, and you get more help text. The next page here, you can see your station network. On the left side is a list of all the available stations that were found in your catalogs. And if you click on them, they are selected and they are used for your session. You can also use this filter to filter, for example, some stations. Maybe you want to schedule a session with including Betzel and Cookie. You can simply click on the stations to add them. If you click on the selected stations, you remove them from the session again. On this page here, you can see all the available sources, and the same logic holds here. By clicking on a source, you add it as the selected to the session. By clicking on the selected sources, you will remove it from the session. There is a convenient way to set up everything for IVS sessions. For example, if you would like to generate a session for one of the IBS sessions, you can simply enter the session code on the stop line here and then click enter. For example, if you would like to schedule session R1926, you just have to enter the code here, hit enter, and it will automatically set up the correct session start time, the correct duration, and the correct station network, as well as some other things. Another very convenient option is to click on this List Next button here. In here, you will have the next sessions of the next 30 days are listed. So for example, if your task is to schedule one of these sessions, you can simply click here, then select the session, click OK, and it will automatically change again the station, the start time of the session, and it will also change the network that is participating, as well as other things which we will see later. Note that the intensive sessions are stored here. Okay, let's continue. So now we can have a look at the parameterization in VChat++. The parameters are distributed as station-based parameters, source-based parameters, and baseline-based parameters. As you can see, our VChat++ tries to be very flexible with the parameterization. This means that in principle, it is possible to give every station or every source or baseline their individual set of parameters. It is also possible that you can change these parameters over time. Most of the time, or by default, all stations get some default parameters. If you want to change these default parameters, you have to select the default parameter here and click on this change button. This is the list of all the parameters that are available in VChat++ for the stations. As you can see, there are quite a few, so probably it's best to stop here in your exercise and have a look at all the parameters and read through what all of those do. For this, or for now, we can leave them to the default parameters, because the default parameters should work reasonably well for our one session. The same is here for the source-based parameters. Again, by default, all sources get these default parameters. You can have a look at the default parameters here. These are the baseline-based parameters. The next page here are the weight factors, and weight factors are something very important in scheduling. So as I said in the tutorial at the beginning, in scheduling you often have the task to find a good balance between some competing requirements that you have. For as an example, I brought up the requirement to have a good sky coverage, as well as the requirement to have a good or a high number of observations in general. And you can't have both of this of it at the same time, and therefore you have to find this balance. And here you get a list of all the optimization criteria VChat++ has, and you can use some of these criteria. By default, these four here are the most important ones, and here you can change the balance between these criteria. If you increase the weight of one of those, then this parameter becomes more important and more important in the scheduling generation. So for example, if I increase this to 3, then the scheduler would really try to get a good sky coverage for all the stations. However, if I would, for example, increase this number of observations parameter, then it would really try to only schedule scans that will lead to a high number of observations. For the sake of the tutorial, I will leave it to the default parameters here. Next, on this page, you can have a look at all the output files that will be generated. So you can see that the output files, they will be stored in a folder out that you can define here. And you can add some operation notes to your outputs, as well as add some contact information if you would like to do it. But here we can also more or less leave everything to the default and simply click on or, and now we can simply start our first scheduling. So we can either click on run here or to the bottom here to start the scheduling, and now it will ask you if you would like to save the XML file. And this XML file is basically the interface between the graphical user interface and the scheduler. So in this XML file, all the settings that you have taken here in the graphical user interface will be stored in the ASCII.txt file. So we can say yes here, and now it says that it has generated a new output folder where this XML file is stored, and you can either just start the scheduling or open the folder directly. And if we do so, you can see that here a lot of files will be generated while the scheduling runs. So now it is finished, and you can see that you have got quite a number of files. For example, you have got this SKD file and this VEX file. And these two files, they are very important because these are basically the files that you distribute to the stations and also to the correlator, where all the information of the session is stored. Additionally, you have here this txt file, and this is the operation notes file. This file is very important and convenient for you because it basically, if you open it, it will list a lot of useful statistics for your session. And these statistics let you easily evaluate if your scheduling went right or wrong. So for example, maybe let's go briefly through this file. So at the very top, you get some general information. And now here, for example, you see how the time is spent for every station. For example, on average, we have around 65% observing time, and we have only about 4% idle time. So this looks quite good. Now here you have a list of the number of observations per baseline. For example, you can see that between Matera and Cookie, there are almost 100 observations, while for example, between Hatrao and Cookie, there is not a single observation. Here you can see how many stations usually participate per scan. So you can see that we have no two station scans because by default they are not allowed, but we can change this if you want. And yeah, you can also see that we have no 11 station scans. And this is again, as I said, simply because we have a global network and it is impossible that all the stations can see the same source simultaneously. You can also see that we have a lot of three station scans, which might probably be not very optimal. But keep in mind, we have just used the default parameters for now, so probably that's something we can work on. In total, we have generated 944 scans and above 12,000 observations. Here again, you have a short summary about the observing mode you have used. And yeah, here are some additional notes for the scheduler. For example, you can see that from these 2,000 observations, around 8,000 come from subnetting scans and the rest is from the standard single source scans. You can also see that we have used fill-in mode quite a lot, and 2,800 observations come from this fill-in mode. Here you can have a look at the sky coverage. So this sky coverage score in particular. So there are a couple of different scores, but in general, the scores range between 0 and 1. If you have a score of 1, this means that this is a perfect sky coverage, while a score of 0 would mean it's the worst sky coverage you could imagine. At the bottom here, you see some statistics, for example, of how many observations or scans there are per station or per source. for every 15 minutes. So for example, station Hatrau, in this first 15 minutes, they have done 6 scans. The next 15 minutes, they have done 3 scans and so on. So every character here represents 15 minutes of the schedule, and the number lists the number of scans that you have in this 15 minutes. And here you can, for example, see for the sources that we have a lot of sources where we only have 1 scan. And this is also something we would like to improve and optimize further, because usually that's not what you want. So in principle, you most of the time would like to have at least 3 scans for each source, because otherwise it will be very tricky or impossible to properly estimate the source coordinates. Okay, here you get more information about the average signal to noise ratio that you get, and a small histogram about the observing time, the distribution, and yeah, there are way more informations here, but I will not go through all of them now. So now our first scheduling is done and is correct. So now we can try to make it better. Therefore, it is important to first define what better really means, because right now we only know what or how much scans and observations we get, or how good our sky coverage is. But in principle, it is hard to tell how good the estimation of our geodetic parameters will work if you just look at these metrics. Therefore, it is also possible to do some simulations in VShed++. The simulation settings can be done here. So you can simply say, I want to simulate my schedule, and now here you have a list of all the simulation parameters that you can use. You can either change the parameters for or use the same parameters for all the stations, or you can use individual parameters for every station. I will keep the first option here, and as you can see, I will do 1000 simulations or runs. This helps us to get some good repeatability values. Here you can define what parameters you would like to estimate. For example, you would like to estimate the Earth orientation parameters, some parameters for the stations, like for example their coordinates, some clock-based parameters, and also some parameters for the troposphere. And you could in principle estimate source coordinates, and so on. So the default parameters that I've used here, they should work very well for 24 hours R1 sessions. So I can keep them to the default parameters. Here you can define the priorities of your session, meaning how important the certain geodetic parameters are for you. So for example, you can say that for you, the Earth orientation parameters are the most important thing. If this is the case, you can simply increase their weight here. Or you can also say, or for example, you could say, no, station coordinates are very important for me. So you can increase this weight here for the station coordinates. And this is basically only used to determine which schedule is the best one for you in the end. So now, we have defined that we would like to simulate our sessions, so we can work on some other topics. So there are, I will go through the other options. For example, here you can use some special algorithms. For example, you could define that you would like to add some calibration scans to your schedule. The calibration scans, they are very useful for several reasons, so it's probably a good idea to add some calibration scans. And I will say that I will add some scans at the session start, 10 minutes after the session started, and I would like to schedule 2 scans at the beginning, and each scan should be 300 seconds long. And similarly, at the end of the session, I would also like to observe 2 of these calibration scans. There are a lot of other options, but I will not go through them in detail now. This page here is also quite important for you, because here you can add some additional conditions. For example, how, or in particular, how often you would like to observe every source. So what is done here is that you can, for example, say that this condition that you would like to define, this will now belong to all the sources, because you can again do it individually for every source if you would like to. But you, in most cases, this should be account all the sources. And you can say, for example, that you would like to at least observe every source 3 times. And then you can add this condition to your scheduling logic. Here are some more options that let you define how to proceed or how to apply these conditions, because internally what VChat++ now does is it will generate one schedule, the first schedule with the full list of sources, and after the first schedule is finished, it will check if this condition is correct for all the sources. If this is not the case, then it will again create a second schedule, and this second schedule will only use a subset of the sources that were available, and it will only use the most important sources, and it will generate another schedule, and so on until all the requirements, or in this case this requirement, is fulfilled. Let's have a look at this in more detail. If I now click on run, I can again save the XML file with the settings and open the output folder directly. And now I have to wait a little bit until the result is done. But you can see here now that we get a lot more files, because first of all, it will do this scheduling iteratively. But on the other hand, yeah, it is already finished. So you can see again that we got the SKD, the VEX, and the operation notes files. Additionally, we got now some simulator.txt and a simulation summary.txt file. And we also got a lot more of these files. And these files, they are basically human readable log files that inform you about the scheduling process. And in this case, it has done it has generated 5 iterations in the scheduling, because to fix this or to find the most important sources. For now, let's have a look at this simulation summary.txt file, because here you get the information about how good you can estimate your geodetic parameters. For example, you've listed here the mean formal errors and the repeatability values of your session. And these are the values that you would expect from your session. And now you have a convenient way to compare your schedules with some other schedules that you've generated to find the best schedule for your use. Here, if we now have a look at the operation notes file and have a look at the number of sources that we have observed, then you will see that we have that most of the sources are now really observed in a lot of scans. So we don't have any one scan of sources that are only observed once. So almost all sources are now observed 3 times or more. So we have fixed the first issue that we have identified. Maybe it's also worthwhile to have a look at one of these iteration text files, because as I said, these are the human readable log files. So here, for example, at the very beginning, it will tell you that it has a total number of sources of 336, and out of those only 335 are available. One is not available because it's too close to the sun and thus should not be observed. What you can see here is more or less a log file that informs you about all the scans that will be observed. For example, it will start with the calibration scans, and here you see which source is observed, which stations are participating in these scans, and also some more information, for example, like how long is the slew time, how long is the idle time of the stations, what's the pre-op time, and what's the observing time. That's the observing duration, the azimuth start and elevation start, and as well as the unwrapped azimuth, so if you take cable wrap into account. In any case, so that's a pretty long text file, and maybe it's also a good idea to have a look at this file once to try to understand what's going on, because it will help you to understand how the scheduling algorithm works. Most importantly for this demonstration here is that at the very end it will give you a short summary, and then it will check the optimization criteria or conditions, and then it will conclude that a new schedule with a reduced source list is necessary, and it will generate a new schedule with now only 113 sources. So this was iteration 0. Next we can for example have a look at this iteration 1. And now you can see that it only considers 113 sources in the next schedule. So now it will generate a new schedule just based on the 113 sources that we have now allowed. And after the scheduling is done, it will again check if this optimization criteria that we have set here, that you would like to observe every source at least 3 times, is fulfilled. It will say no, it's not fulfilled, so it will generate a new iteration or a new schedule with a reduced number of sources. And it will do this 3 more times until it is satisfied. So at the last iteration, you can see that it has now only 82 sources left, and it will again go through the whole scheduling process, and at the very end, which would be here, there it would again check these conditions, and it would conclude that there is no source left that has to be included, so every source has the minimum number of scans, and thus it would not generate a new iteration. So now we can again maybe have a look at the operation node file. So let's close the other files that we have opened, and we can have a look at, or maybe it's also nice to open our previous version. So on the left hand side is now our first schedule. Here is the second schedule that we have generated. And if you compare those files, then for example, you can see that on the first schedule we had 12,000 something scans. Here we have 12,400. Here previously we had 12,200. So we slightly increased the number of observations, but that was not the primary goal of our optimization. So here, if you remember, we did in total schedule 141 sources, and the problem was that many of the sources, they had only one scan in total. So if I look here, there are quite a number of sources that only have one scan in the whole schedule. And in contrast with the new schedule, you can see that we have now only observed 82 sources, or 82 different sources, but all the sources have at least 3 scans, and that was exactly what we tried to achieve. So this fix was already successful, and now we can move on and try to increase the schedule even further. The next thing we can do is we can have a look at the balance between this optimization criteria that I talked about earlier. So here, let's go to this weight factors page. And here we can change the balance. For example, I could try to generate a new schedule where I significantly increase the weight for the number of observations and also the weight for the duration a little bit. And I also decrease the weight for the sky coverage. If I now click on run, I will generate a new schedule, a different with different scheduling parameters or with a different balance. So it will take a couple of seconds, but then it's done. And I can open again the operation notes files, for example, and see that now I get 13,400, over 13,400 observations, so significantly more observations, 1,000 more. So, but if I compare the numbers, probably I get a little bit of a weaker sky coverage. So here we have significantly increased the number of observations, but of course, more importantly is to look at if our simulation results increased as well. So I can again open this simulation summary txt file and compare it with our previous result. So again, the previous result is on the left hand side, the new result is on the right side. You can see previously we had 2400 or almost 2500 observations. Now schedule has 13,400 observations, and now I could simply go ahead and compare the simulation results. For example, you can see that the mean formal error is slightly better in the second version. Also, the polar motion is a little bit better, and so on. So yeah, you can simply go ahead and compare all these parameters, but of course, it's very labor intensive and very inefficient to do it like this. So in principle, it's possible that you can now simply go ahead and brute force try different parameters, different balances, and compare the simulation results. But there is a way more convenient option to do this, and this is what's called the multi-scheduling. So here is the multi-scheduling page, and you can start or enable multi-scheduling. And what multi-scheduling does is, instead of generating, so far we have only generated one schedule at the end. So instead of generating only one schedule, you can now automatically generate a lot more schedules by using different parameters, for example. So here on the left hand side, you see all the parameters that can be tested. And you can, for example, say, so in our previous test, we have simply changed some of the weight factors, the four most important ones, and changed the values that we have used for these weight factors. So if I want to do this automatically, then I can simply select the weight factor and add it to the multi-scheduling approach. And for example, say which values should it test. So for example, it can run one schedule with a value of 0, one with a schedule with a value of 0.33, and so on. So you can simply remove or add new values if you like. For example, you would also like to test a value of 1.3 or whatever, or remove some of the old ones. So you can do whatever you like here. You can also automatically generate some values. For example, if I want to test all values from 0 to 1 with a step of 0.1, I can click on generate and it will automatically generate all the values for me. So in this example, I will simply add the parameter here. And what you now see is that the total number of schedules that it will generate is now 4. So I can do now the exact same with the next parameter. For example, test not only values for sky coverage, but also for the number of observations. And now you can see that the total number of schedule is now 16, because it has first, it tests all the combination of different values that you have here between the parameters. Next, you can, for example, add the third parameter. Now you are at 64 different schedules, and so on. So in principle, you could then start the scheduling and look at the result. And for this exercise, let's simply do it. It will probably take a couple of minutes, but not too much. So as you can see, is that it has now started the scheduling. So in total, it will generate 64 schedules. And you can see that it has now extended the name with this version 001. and so on. Here is version 004. So the 64 schedules, they have now a version number attached. And you can also see that it will generate the schedules in parallel. So it will automatically find the CPUs that are available and use all the CPUs for scheduling. And yeah, if you don't want to use all the CPUs, you can have a look at this multi-core support, and you can, for example, by hand change the number of cores that you would like to use. For example, you can say, okay, just use 4 cores at a time, but usually automatic, let it search them automatically works quite well. Okay, you can still see that there is one process running in the graphical user interface. While this process is the one that is running, so maybe I forgot to mention it, on the bottom here you see that we have here these log files. So in these log files, so these were all the previous runs, we can close those, but in these log files you get a lot of information of what's going on, what the scheduler is currently doing, and so on. And yeah, so it has already finished a lot of schedules, but probably will take 1 or 2 more minutes. While this is the case, you can notice that you can still use the graphical user interface as you like. So you can still switch between the parameters, set up your new next schedule, or whatever you would like to do. Now we can have a look back at our result, because the whole scheduling is now finished. It says that it has, or let's have a look at the log file at the very bottom. So here you can see that it took around 2 minutes on my computer to generate the 64 different schedules. And it also says that the recommended schedule is version 31. And also it lists some alternative schedules, which are also pretty good. But how does it determine that the recommended version is version 31? Because if I now would, for example, have a look at this simulation summary txt file, I would now have access to all the simulation results from all the different versions. So in total there were 64 different schedules, and it has found that version 31 is the best one. And if you now compare all the simulation results, for example for polar motion, you would see that on average, this schedule has the best performance out of all the 64 different versions. And you have here the mean formal errors and below the repeatabilities. And yeah, so this is again evaluated based on the settings we have used here on this priority tab. So if you, for example, would So based on these settings, the recommendation of what's the best schedule is sent or is printed out. So in principle, probably version 31 is the version to use. And this is probably the version which has the best balance between all the optimization criteria. I can now, for example, have a look at this version 31. .operation text file. If I open it, then I would see, okay, the best balance that was found was by using a sky coverage of 0.33, number of observation of 1, and a duration of 0.67. So this seems to be the best, or this seems to be a good balance for this session to get some very or some good or high precision simulation results. In the remaining couple of minutes, let us briefly recap of what we have done so far and what options in VChat++ we have already explored. So if you remember, our main task was to schedule one session, namely the session R1995. Let's quickly redo all the steps in a plain so after starting VChat++. The first thing we did was going to this general tab and add, or let's search for the session that we are about to schedule. It was this R1995, so we simply loaded all the settings. The next thing we did is we went to the simulation tab and we enabled that we want to simulate the schedule. Next, we went to disk conditions and added a condition that we would like to at least observe every source 3 times. Next step was that we went to the multi-scheduling page and then we have selected several different parameters that are necessary or that we want to test in the scheduling to find out which combination of parameters or which combination of weight factors is the perfect one for our scheduling purpose. In the simulator, we have also defined what the priorities of our session is. And then we simply clicked on Run to start the scheduling. In the next couple of videos, we will go into more details about the different algorithms that you can select and also, most importantly, about the station setup or the setups in general for the station sources and baselines, how to change them and how to manipulate them. But for now, I think this was a good first lecture on VLBI scheduling. And maybe it's now your turn to try out, to play around a little bit with the software. And I think most importantly, it is really to get a feeling about how it's working and to try out different buttons or combinations and simply experiment a little bit with all the settings you can do, look at the results and so on. And if you have any questions, then you can always just contact me and I'm happy to help you. And yeah, with this, I would like to stop now and close this session. And as I said, there will be more videos on our YouTube channel about different topics with VChat++. Thank you for your attention. Goodbye.